recall, what would you miss from way back?
The smell of the tobacco pipe coming up across the air. you know, Johnny, being at the bottom of the air, you smell the tobacco coming up.
And then you had Michael O'Connor up at the top of the hill. And Michael used to actually, he had a farm and he used to supply nearly everyone with turnips and spuds and the cabbage and everything. You know, he'd throw it in over the gate when he'd be passing.
And my memory, like on a Sunday morning coming down from Mass, is that you'd smell the fry, like from Hayden's down, like you'd smell the rashers and the sausages.
And you remember Ken's crisps? I think they were the first crisps made in Ireland. Yeah. Ken Dickinson down Ken by Furbank.
There was only two phones in Slieverue when I was growing up. There was one up in Welsh's, Auntie Kitty's and Uncle Billy's.
A plain crisp with a little packet of salt. And
but they were lovely crisps.
And my dad like would have the rashers and sausages on Easter Sunday. He'd be saying, how many eggs are you going to eat? Like, but they'd be ordinary eggs. They wouldn't be just chocolate eggs.
That phone was a pay phone. You press button B to get your money back and press button A to go through.
Oh, there were lots of characters in it. Everyone was a character.
There were probably more wit around too with lads as well.
There were very witty people.
My godfather was the best character. He was the postman.
And you Dick Murphy, didn't you catch him? He was the postman.
But when he was delivering, he wouldn't talk. He'd go in, down the letter, and walk out. Because if he was talking, he'd be kept talking. Every house he goes to. But when he'd be back to civvies then, when he'd take the uniform off at dinner time, he talked, the cows come home.
There was a great community spirit around Slieverue.
You see, people didn't travel much in those days. Now the bicycles were very popular in our time, but before that, people had to walk.
And then come to the winter then, you see, there where that door is, there was a window there, and the table was across there, and they'd be playing cards here.
I mean, in those days, you could get up on your bicycle and go a couple of miles around the parish, and I had relations living over the way and call over on them and that, you know.
And then Mixie Powell would come along then, Catherine's uncle, and he'd have 5 or 6 pound of sausages coming. And there were rangers in the house at the time, and the doll would be looking for sausages. And she only had one frying pan. So she said to Mixie one night, if you're going to bring all them sausages, she said, bring me home a new frying pan. So about 2 nights after, he settled in with a new frying pan to her. So she had 2 frying pans going.
It was an occasion even with the family, if they were in the next parish, like to visit.
Yeah.
So when they came, oh, there was cake and nice things, and the china was taken out. Always.
My earliest memories was of the village. The village was a attached village.
We were more self-sufficient as well because like there was a garden everywhere and you had your own potatoes and your own vegetables.
Everyone grew vegetables in their gardens, which they had to do anyway, kind of during the war and the emergency, as it was called in those days, you know.
In that time, people had no overheads whatsoever. Now we have television, we have mobile phones, everything is costing money, mortgages. Mortgages were never heard of that time. And people got married, there was always the house up the road was vacant. People give it to them, do it up.
1956, when I was home on holiday, last week of holidays, I met Pat.
Where'd you meet?
At a fete in Kilmacow. And we agreed to meet the following spring. I used to get home twice a year. And so we did. And we met again at the end of the summer. And then we arranged to get engaged the following time.
I lived at home until I got married. Like, I walked out my door, and it was then I moved out of home.
It went from there. 2.5 years later, we got married. I was still only home from England, and I moved in here. And when I moved in here, as was the custom at the time, the in-laws remained in it, anybody that was there.
It was, like, nearly set for us. Like, you went to school, and you got a job, and you worked.
There was... Pat's father was here. His sister was here, she worked in Waterford, in W.A. Deely's at the time. And his brother Billy was here, he worked in Clovermead's at the time.
If you're happy with what you're doing, you need never go on a holiday. You need never go on a holiday. If you want a holiday, get up and walk down the road there. You see the trees, you see the birds. Talk to yourself, do whatever you like. You might meet someone to talk to. If you didn't, well, fair enough. Mind is relaxed.
Every time we got a chance, if we got two or three fellas together, we were out hurling, that's it.
We tried to keep it at ground hurling so we wouldn't be breaking windows.
We'd be out on the street, poking the ball against the wall. When no one else is in, well, somebody else, but I broke more windows around the place.
Our hurling pitch was the road outside. Yeah. We put down, down there, just outside Kathleen's, we put down a jumper there and a jumper there, and up at Franny's, we put down two more jumpers.
And most people, including the girls, like, they had knitted pullovers, because knitting was the, I suppose, just from financial reasons at the time, because there wasn't any money around.
There was four in our family, one brother and two sisters. But then John said there was seven in five.
There were so many in all the houses that you had a friend in every house. Mm. And all my brothers and sisters had a friend in every house, because you were born like steps of stairs, really, you know, and there's 10 in a family.
But yes. There were some families, there was 14, and there was even Milets, they had a
18
or something, in the family.
And the elder always minded the younger. You just had no choice. Yeah.
14 of us could head off on bicycles to go swimming in Kilmacow.
You could go down along the Barrow Bridge and go across the bridge over onto Camp Isle there, Great Island.
We'd just have our swimming togs and a towel, and you might have a few sweets or a sandwich. And we entertained ourselves all summer.
Down the knock, up we had. Down behind us, yeah, up the woods. Like.
Oh, we used to always walk to Kearney Stream and go up to Tory Hill and climb the hill. And
the thing would be to get a sweet can maybe in the evenings, and we used to have to go down to the well, which was downstream from here.
We went then, when we got older, then we went off for walks and we picked blackberries. And we picked blackcurrants in Barton's, which was a great thing because you got a few bob.
We'd have just tin cans. Yeah. You're going in, you're picking them off, and then you put them all into a bucket. And Mrs. Griffin of the shop, Betty's and Patty's mother, she used to buy the blackberries from us.
They delivered barrels first. So she bought them, all the kids at the place would all pick blackberries.
Because we used to
put water in.
What did we do? We all added the water.
We used to be a little bit illegal with it in some ways. We'd add water in to get the weight.
That was our mischief.
And she'd put it into her weighing scales. But her weighing scales, she had holes in it. So that all the water that we were putting in drained off.
We also picked potatoes. Tinned turnips.
It was no easy task then to put a couple of bags on your knees and bend down, and your poor hands from the hot clay and the stones and the weeds pulling.
Picking potatoes in Hogan's, that was just the best place ever, because they used to bring big teapots of tea down the field and big sandwiches, and we'd all sit down and have the hot tea and the picnic in the field. Mm-hmm. And then at lunchtime, we all went up to the house.
I lived outdoor most of the time. From the morning that I get up, because the shop was always full. And anyway, if it wasn't, you'd be sent out.
Well, we played skipping and we played beddies.
Hopscotch, it came to be afterwards.
On the road outside in the circle, like, you'd have a whip, the top, a spinning top, and you'd have a whip and you'd whip it.
We used to go over to take the numbers of the cows, then they were coming up, getting a little bit more plentiful.
I don't know if you remember playing shop.
Shop was a big one, we all had,
you'd have the empty box of cornflakes and the jams, and you'd get your mum and they'd save them all up.
In Slieverue then, of course, we used to go down Lynch's Bogs.
Your friends would come and they'd have pretend money, we'd have stones or
cowboys, Indians, and throwing ferns, making camps. Mm.
We used to skate on the Airmont Road.
Yeah.
You know,
do you remember the quarry? You remember the water in the quarry?
Yeah.
Just to freeze over, we used to be down there in the winter skating on that. It's a great old time, isn't
it? And do you remember John had the electricity came? We had no electricity when we were children.
But when they were pitching toss, my job used to be, they turn the bicycle upside down, the dynamo.
And the first light on the street.
Yeah.
And it was a marvellous thing, and we'd be left out to play.
Yeah.
Maybe for an hour once the light came on, you know, in the winter time where you wouldn't normally have been out.
So when the pennies had come down in the dark, they'd be throwing them up in the dark. And when they come down, I'd have to twist the pedal and they'd see it was heads or hats, you know.
About 57, I think, 56, 57, our electricity.
We were later.
Were you?
Yeah, we were later. Yeah. We had it in Glenmore before I was married.
All right.
But when I came here, we happened to be in an island.
There was a line
coming to Ballymountain, and there was a line coming to Nicholastown, and there was a line coming to Ballincrae.
Yeah, you had to wait for it.
But everybody would have to agree to take
it. That's right, that was the big thing.
Everybody would have to agree to take it, and we were a house up here on our own. And so there was a bit of disagreement. People weren't that anxious to take it. It was new and some people wouldn't take it.
Yeah, I remember as a child we had no water in the house and no electricity. But you didn't know any different. You know, it just wasn't. But I do remember it actually coming.
It seemed so bright. So bright. But there were a lot. My father was very handy with a lot of those things. He was a small farmer. But besides that, he was very interested in a lot of that.
But you see, didn't know any better then, really, because none of the houses down the my post at the time would have had it. I even remember Margaret Powers now with the little tilly lamp and the oil, you know, lighting in the bar, like, you know what I mean? And we had one of them in the kitchen, but you had the candle going up to bed, like.
And Ned Cavanagh of an uncle of Morris Cavanagh's and them in Waterford now, and knew that well. And he came out here to start the electricity wiring up. And I remember, well, it was this room here for all the world that he put in one plug and one light and said to him, "Now, Dick, follow on from that yourself."
They were happy days, though, really. Like, you know what I mean? You'd be trying to read your comic, Dandy and Beano, with the candlelight, you know, really.
I remember one of the first things that was bought in electricity, in the electric, was an electric fire with a long, long cable that was able to be plugged in here and brought around to each room, maybe before we go to bed or that, and then I just warm up the rooms and that, you know.
They had a battery radio and you used to listen to the radio, but every so often, because the battery radios were very inconsistent, to say the least of things, you know, there'd be a lot of interference on it. But old John Forrestal, anyway, when it come to 6 o'clock, we listened to the news, and if interference came on the radio, he'd say to his sister, he said, "That's Bridie Forrestal below cooking the sausages for Billy, and interrupting the radio."
Then, like, I remember the time President Kennedy came to New Ross, and we were after getting the telly inside an RTV rentals at the time. And, you know, I think there were a crowd below in the milepost and we all watching President Kennedy's visit, like, you know.
We had no television at the time. And we used to all go down and watch The Fugitive down in my Auntie Mary. She was my aunt.
Yeah.
You know, we used to go there and there could be 20, 30 children in there watching The Virginian or the Fugitive.
Yeah. My poor aunt, she lived out in the middle of Fenner. And when she came to live with me with Granny and Granddad, and she came up to the house one day, and Giles Mitchell was doing the nails, and she was sitting there. She was fidgeting, and she was looking at me again. "You dirty old bastard," she said, "stop looking up me skirt. You're an awful dirty old man."
Back away. Well, at that stage, you see, here we had no water as well. So we were kind of kept busy enough.
The water and water came around 1967, 68, around that time.
Around that time, wasn't it?
There was a pump halfway down the road, then that went. We used to go to the creamery for water.
That's right,
creamery.
That's interesting one, actually. We used to have to go to the local creamery
for our water.
Yeah.
And we used to go to down to Donovan's for our milk.
That's right.
Yeah. I remember going to the creamery when there was snow on the ground for a wheelbarrow and a kind of a bin.
We used to go in the bucket. Yeah. We used to go 2 buckets of water over to the creamery with 2 buckets and bring it back on the bike. And you might have a 500 litre of coal as well
thrown in
the far down near the pedals, like, you know, to be, you'd walk home with this.
But like when you didn't go down to Hartley's for water, we used to go down to Lynch Welch's down the fields, remember, for
that's,
the water.
In the summertime.
Right,
in the summertime.
Yeah.
The spring down there was kind of clearer than Hartley's and the water was ice cold.
Yeah.
And we'd get out over our ditch over and go down through about 3 or 4 fields.
Yeah. Yeah. I remember in our house at home, we used to have a pump. There were a well over the yard, and then they got it pumped across, you know, the big hand pumps.
Mm.
And that was brilliant, you know, to have that. We didn't have to go down into the well, but it was tough. Mm. Every house is the same.
The papers just come into the station.
Oh, yeah.
The train station, you had to go in and get them every morning.
Well, I had to cycle down to the Waterford station for the Independent, and then I'd have to go over to the creamery to bring the papers over to the creamery.
We got very posh then. My father got a churn, so he didn't have to go every evening. He filled the churn every Saturday, and to do you for maybe 3 days or something. Yeah. You know?
I can never remember that there wasn't a bucket of milk behind the door in the hall, you know, standing into a bucket of cold water.
Going to the creamy with a horse and car was a different thing. Yeah. You know, you go down there every morning with a horse and car, and you were... You said that you were never going to meet the same person every morning. You know, it was a great thing because you had
very
different
sociable.
People. Very sociable. Because you could end maybe 40 or 50 going to the creamery and you would arrive down. The guy you met last week would be 3 cars ahead of you. You know what I mean? So it was a... You were speaking to everyone in the parish.
Mm. The L&N van used to...
That used to come to the houses. Mm.
Yeah, that was the mobile shop. Mm.
Okay.
It came out every Wednesday.
That's right.
And it stopped down in the middle of the village.
There was 2 men on that. It was a big van done out like a shop.
George and John.
Yeah. Mm.
And one of them drove and the other man was in the back.
Everyone got the same items every week, didn't they, Kathleen?
Yeah.
There was 3 shops, Murphy's and herself and Rocket's had a big shop.
Yeah, Murphy's over.
Mum's list was tea, sugar, bread, butter, flour and matches.
And the bread van as well, used to call
bread van and the
Portlaw Bakery, used to actually stop and sell the bread out of there.
Yeah.
Well, the bread men were coming around in my time as well, you know, after I got married.
Or even going up to Mary Gary, like, and I told you that just before we went on. Mary Gary was the shop above in Slieverue, and she bought me my first novena book of rosaries. I still have it over, like.
I remember the first oranges coming into Rockets below and the bananas. We never saw
and
a
the
banana.
The war was over.
She kind of listened to all our stories and fixed up more people with people,
didn't
she?
Yeah.
All the shops in town, including the drapers, were full of oranges everywhere.
Then, you know, he was in this evening, like, you know what I mean? Where were you, like, you know, he was around. That was my late husband, John, and he lived in Glenmore.
And my mother used to talk as well of the shop that was down the road from the school here.
In Murphy's shop, actually, below in Slieverue then, was the right gathering place for everyone, you know?
And they used to hand in old copies to the shop.
When you walked in, even like someone would be sitting down having a cigarette at the door and having a chat to the lady behind the counter.
There was no such thing as wrappings or papers, and they used to take the page and they'd wrap it up into a cone and you got your sweets in that cone.
Mother had an account in Murphy's and Griffin's, and we used to put everything was, you know, on the slate. And then we'd pay and she'd say, what are all these sweets and lollies and chips and stuff and soft drinks?
And Mary was brilliant. Mary fed everyone, I'd say, in the parish. She used to look after more people. God, she was a brilliant woman.
It was like a drop-in centre, Murphy's shop.
It was great.
We had good fun. We'd go down the back of Murphy's shop and there was a stream down there. We'd sit down there for the afternoon. We investigated big old houses.
I suppose about 14, 15... And you'd be hanging around Kathleen O'Brien's shop in the Mile Post. Katie Rocket then left us come into the little snug she had at the side. But, you know, you get a bottle of Jaffour in your bag of crisp. If you made nice, then you got thrown out. You know, you had to be very quiet with it. Katie was strict, like.
And Niles took over Rockets then.
Rockets then
was the bigger.
Yeah.
It took off.
They
built
then,
on
yeah.
the big lounge and
just...
Yeah.
Made it all the different...
Yeah. Yeah, there's Rockets and Powers down there.
Yeah. You definitely wouldn't be allowed into Powers anyway. We wouldn't last long if we were.
You wouldn't get in the door.
You couldn't even course down there.
I suppose maybe it's a bit timid for many. But there's an awful lot of people wouldn't face into it because they'd have to keep it down and keep it quiet.
Jimmy Ned's, they call it. Jimmy Ned.
Yeah.
Do you remember? That was a great pub, wasn't it?
The place was known as Jimmy Ned's. It wasn't a reference that she relished. Her father's name was James Parr.
They had a reputation of, you know, for having a sing-song there, and you never know. They'd call on somebody to sing a song and that sparked the whole thing off. Somebody then would arrive with a melodeon.
Yeah.
Powers would have been more kind of a quaint old pub, really, you know what I mean? And she never had, say, pints or anything. It was small or large. If you went in looking for a pint of stout, she'd be or a bottle of stout, small or large, she'd say to you.
Much later years, there was a couple of Yanks arrived in one night.
And she might only give you 2 or 3 drinks and you could say, you'll have to go now, you've had enough. That's the way she was.
This fellow was doing a scan of the shelves anyways. What was he going to drink and make sure he wasn't going to poison himself or whatever. So he nudged the other fellow. He says, has he got any draft? And He wants to know if you have any draft. I said, yeah, I have. I said, it's coming in under the door.
Remember back in the day at lunchtime, you'd see all the crowd coming up from Clover. They were able to drink and drive back then, you know, come up for their little cure, especially on a Monday. The cross below would be packed.
Always great sing songs, yeah. You could have a sing song on a Saturday and a Sunday morning.
Yeah, although I'd say now it was only up for a glass of water and a sandwich.
Whenever I'm standing beside her, sure my elbow just reaches her knee. Oh, Patsy McCann, will you marry me, daughter? Oh, Patsy McCann, she's the girl you should wed. 10 golden sovereigns down I will give you, a three-legged stool and a fine feather bed.
And I'd hear a song now, and I'd say, oh, that's such and such a song. I might know the name of the song, but I could say who always sang it.
Lyons and Slieverue was buzzing at that time. Oh. All the groups and used the to come and play. And
Waves played here, Christy Moore played here, Brendan Grace.
But Simon were the big ones, weren't they? Yeah. The place was full.
And Rocky Mills, Laura, all those people played here. Loudest Whisper, good bands, you know.
The Furies would have been here nearly every weekend. Davy Arthur.
Mr. Pussy used to come this way. Do you remember Mr. Pussy, lad?
I remember.
Yeah, we do.
Kathleen's mother actually used to do the door, and if you went in 5 minutes to closing time, you wouldn't get in past the door, you still have to pay.
And if you went in early, that? She'd come down after you.
Oh, yeah, you wouldn't get in at any stage, you know.
Bono came to play. He wanted to play, but I think the lounge was more of a slightly country western, even though Monkfish and them Waves and that played. So what she did was she rang Mrs. Tracy Anna in the showboat and got him a gig with her on the phone and sent Bono into Anna.
You know, the older men would be in the bar. They wouldn't come into the lounge now where us younger crowd used to be at the time.
So everyone always had their own seat. And Jimmy Butler from the Airman Road always sat here. There was a Mr. Kelly from Ferrybank always sat on that side. The far corner of the front of the bar was Burnell. He was a Larry C from Giles's. He always sat there, and he used to always, he'd be pairing, he'd have his pipe and he'd have his plug of tobacco and he'd be pairing. He always had a knife in his hand, which was a bit weird at a counter, but. And next to him, Jim Houston, he was a big man that used to wear dungarees, and he'd cycle a bike, and his bike would be at the wall, at that window at 11 o'clock every morning.
He used to tell us he'd have a yearly wash with the Picker Dunn. Do you remember him, Admiral?
No,
yeah. Do you remember the Picker Dunn?
I know the Picker Dunn, but I never
met
him.
Yeah, she was a grandchild singer, but he used to say below in Lines is when he'd come. Now he's kind of have another 2 months to go now to me yearly wash. Yeah. And I'd say that was true. Because you wouldn't sit near him now, I tell you, you know what I mean?
Dick Connick used to go down to have his few pints in the pub down in Stapleton's.
Yeah, yeah.
And he always called to my mother on the way home for bread soda.
Mm.
Because bread soda was a cure for a heartburn.
Oh, right.
And John Marrow was another great character. He said, you'd get 8 bottles of stout for £1 that time. 8 bottles of stout. And there was fellas drinking 8 bottles of stout every night, you know, and they could drink 12.
No one used to go to Stapleton's, only the men, really, years ago.
But the women weren't allowed into Stapleton's.
Well, there was no tiles for me,
you
see.
Yeah. Was that what the reason was?
Yeah.
Never knew that.
It was just a one-room
just
pub.
A man's place.
Yeah,
really.
Man's pub with a fireplace.
I mean, I learned how to play cards down there. And if you made a mistake down there, you were dead. And you were playing the 30. We called it a rubber at the time.
So Biddy Jones tells me that there was house dances at the time. And one of the places for the house dances was one of the houses, the number of 17, Slieverue, in Biddy Grace's house, Biddy Jones, as we knew her then.
Jim B, God rest him, he used to play the accordion, and Tommy Grant, beyond the spa, used to play the fiddle. And then the neighbours would be around here, come in.
I don't really remember the house dances now. That had been a bit before my time. But other than that, you had some of the platforms. And there was one over, it used to be at the back of where the well, the road, of course, is crossing it now there, but the creamery used to be over there and down from where the creamery was. There was a nice spot for the platform there.
The platform started then, and it started up in Rapatrick. There's the committee there, the late Dick McBride was one of them, and Jimmy Marr of the village and Paddy Cashin of the village and Tom Purcell of Gorteans and Paddy Cameron of Clune at that time. And it was tuppence, two pennies.
Down in Glenmore at the Scow Bridge, well, halfway to Glenmore just goes the Scow platform. And that one, they would travel on bicycles, that from a bigger area to it.
And then there's another one up in one of that books down here. I can't come down there with those a light. Yeah.
By the guards?
Oh, yeah, he shone a light up in me face and I had to get off of the bike. And he said to me, "Where's your light?" he said to me. I said, "It's next to me liver," says I to him. Oh, says he, "That's the right place to have to keep your hand on it."
There were different ones all over.
There were one in the Scow, there were one in Shambo beyond.
There was one in Rapatrick.
Mm. Generally in every parish there were dance
balls. Dave Bulger was the musician.
That's right, yeah.
John in the Scow Bridge. And Joey what was it? It's later than you think.
That's right, yeah.
You used to sing that about 9:30.
Oh, they were all good dancers. My mother was a lovely step dancer now and a singer, and I was taken after for the dancing. And, you know, and then the pub started then, you know, and used to hold me up with the two legs, one to catch me under the shoulders, another fella catch me with the two legs, and I'd be up on the stage in a minute.
Well, there was quite a good bit of entertainment, it wasn't. Not and the dances, good. Of course, used to go on very late. In the summertime, they used to be from 10 till 4.
Yeah.
The band had come on the stage then, and that was, I can't think of her name now, Sadie Byrne. And she'd come on the stage, and the next thing she goes to the microphone, and she'd say, "Now, take your partners now for an old-time struggle." And that would mean an old-time waltz. And that would start out.
Well, they all were. We used to go to all these pioneer socials and things. It was a kind of a, all, in all the different parishes, we'll say, there'd be mass and there'd be benediction and then there'd be a supper and there'd be a dance. Go to Kilmacow, Munkine, all those places they used to take place. Portlaw.
We used to walk from Slieverue over to Big Wood to discos
and
on Glenmore Thursday night.
And Glenmore was another place, yeah.
And then when we get a bit older, it was like the Barrowland in New Ross. Mm. And it was, I was there, I think, maybe about 2 years with the Olympia in Waterford, which was the ballroom. Mm. And the Audrey show was magic. Huge. Like,
but there was a youth club back in the day now when I was young. And Jimmy Guiry actually was their youth leader. That was back mid-60s. And Eddie Hartley.
Yeah, because socially there was no lacking socially. I think we had plenty going on.
And then the priest was always down with us. At the time, it was Father O'Dwyer. And he didn't like him mixing with the boys now. So there'd be a load of young ones then. Pushed into his car going home, you'd be dropped at your own house.
But we walked a lot of the ways. We would walk from Slieverue down to the
Audrey. That's right. Yeah.
And anyone, if you got a man, he'd walk you back to Slieverue and maybe him walk back to town after that. Mm. Yeah.
Those were real men.
When I look back, and look at people that lived in that time, from my own family, a lot of them emigrated to America, but the famine never hit kind of South Kilkenny very much at all. And in Ringville itself, you had Lady Esmond, Lady Letitia Esmond, and she was exceedingly generous to people. And so much so, she built Ringville School, and the old school, I'd call it. Yeah. And she built the new one as well that I went to. She built that one.
She had ships going to sea, didn't she?
Yeah, she was a wealthy landowner.
We lived in Ringville.
There was a fund, a trust that was entrusted to the parish priest, and that was for buying shoes for needy families, and that was there when I was there.
Apparently she left in her will money for the poor children in Ringville School for as long as grass would grow and water flow.
We say the school was built like in 1879. My grandfather actually, he went to the old school, which is a attached school down down the Castle Lane. And he went for one day there in 1879. And then when the new school opened, he went up there in August of that year.
When I went to Ringville School first, it was dry toilets. We didn't have any water. We had to go to the well for the water in the, boil it in the kettle. We used to have cocoa. Never tea or anything like that. It was always cocoa.
But when I went to school, we had two teachers there then. The principal who came in 1924, Julia Cotter, she was from Cork, and she later married a Power from Waterford. So Mrs. Power, we knew her as. And Mrs. Burke was way ahead of her time as a teacher. She was a gregarious type of person and travelled widely. And her method of teaching was kind of telling stories about her past. But what she had was little trays of sand, maybe half inch thick or so, which is filled with sand, and wooden skewers from the butchers. And that's the way you learn to write, in the sand, and then you could refresh it again and do it again.
This is the 16th of April, 1988, and I'm here at Rosslea Harbour with Paddy and Bridie Burke. And of course, both of them are natives of the parish of Slieverue. And Bridie, you were yourself for many, many years teaching in Ringville.
Oh, yes, until 1963.
You were retired in 1963?
Yeah.
And Bridie, when did you start in Ringville? About?
In October 1920.
October 1920?
Yeah.
And you succeeded your?
My sister.
Your sister?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. She succeeded my mother.
Yes. And your mother was teaching before you there?
Oh, yes, she taught in. And grandmother. Mother died in 1915.
Yes.
15.
First school in Slieverue was inside the church gate, nearly in line with Stapleton's. And that's why actually there's no graves inside the gates, because the school was there. There's quite a green patch there. And then in 1884, I think they went up to the first school, the solid school. I think there was three teachers in that school, and that people went there to 1966, when they left that school. And that school is today, it's somebody's house, it's a residence. And they came down then to the new school in Slieverue in 1966, which was it was very modern, it was beautiful at the time, it was great. And Ringville opened the same year.
Yeah, the two new schools opened at exactly the same time. They were blessed, of course, by the bishop at the same time and all that.
Oh, that's a very cute picture of me and my brother Kevin taken down in the old National School in Slieverue.
Here.
Yeah, that's me there. Butter wouldn't melt in my mouth, as you can see. Kevin is an awful bloody rascal, though.
It was up from the shop there, Griffin's Corner, up to the left there was the old school where we went to school.
It was very strange. In up to about fourth class, there was just two rooms between them. And there was an opening as wide as that. So it was very difficult for the teachers, I'd imagine.
Yeah.
You teaching here and I here. And, you could hear one another.
But the big room was the first, and there was a fireplace there.
You wouldn't feel the fire, yes, they were standing in front of
you. Yeah, exactly.
And I can remember being asked to light the fire before school. And I can remember saying to myself, I don't know how to light this fire. So I remember rolling paper up and a few sticks that were probably got there in the bog somewhere. But I couldn't get this fire going. But I, probably 5 or 6 at the time.
The main teacher, I suppose, at that time, the master, was Mr. Carey. And he lived a few miles away over Kilmacow Parish. And we had another teacher who was coming out from Waterford, Miss Den.
Miss Den was a lovely, lovely, lovely teacher.
If they came in bed, you may God help you.
I can remember learning how to knit. I can't remember learning how to do anything else.
And just corporal punishment. The corporal punishment. Bang, bang, bang the whole time.
I used to get slapped every Friday because I didn't know my spellings. And she'd have this cane.
Yeah.
And she'd whip you, like, with the cane on a cold morning, like, you know.
All you'd hear from was Fig on Bata. And she'd lace the hands off you. Oh, yeah, she was a demon.
Fig on Bata.
Yeah, yeah.
If you went home and said that you got a beating off the teacher, you'd probably get another one when you went home. You'd get another clatter anyway. Wouldn't you? You must have done something wrong, like.
And she was a Tipperary woman and loved anybody that went in with the colours blue and yellow on them were like hot favourites for the day. You were sure to get on her in her good books for the day you had the blue and yellow on.
The school now, when you'd be getting your holidays, your summer holidays, the excitement the day that you got your holidays, but you spent all day cleaning the windows. We had to clean the windows before we went. And then the teacher had, she came with a can, what we called a milk can, with sweet boiled sweets, you know. So just before we left, we all got to share sweets.
Miss Denny was
you do buy anything, you're just waiting all day to get those sweets, looking at the can was there before she opened it.
During the fine weather, we had milk.
You'd smell the cocoa when you go in the morning, and like you'd get your chance like to stir the cocoa, like, and it was great. Like
the bigger boys, we say the last 2 years we were there, we had to walk down Danny Whalen's Lane, maybe about a half a mile for water, and on the way back we'd be collecting. I remember hurts; they were lovely, beautiful little small fruit on the way back, and of course we had to put the kettle on the fire then on the crock. And boil it up then and make the cocoa.
If you were able to stir it, you got a mug of cocoa. And my God, it was the nicest thing ever. Yeah. Like, I can still taste it. Like,
yeah.
Really strong.
Yeah.
To this day, the smell of cocoa is just off-putting. I remember we just had to drink cocoa because that was what you got. But I absolutely hated it.
There was great comradeship that time. And even going to school of a wet day, the farmers around had come with the horses and cars to pick up the children.
Yeah.
And they'd pick up the neighbours' children too that wouldn't have transport.
I must tell you, when I hated going to school, and I can remember clinging to Brendan Welch's wall there.
Yeah.
And clinging to it, so you couldn't pull me away from it.
I remember even with ours here, at the beginning of them, we'd get up in the morning and Patrick would for the cows and I'd get the breakfast.
Yeah.
And he'd bring in the cows and he'd tie them around the yard. Yeah. And the two oldest, especially Alia and PJ, Pat would come in then for his breakfast and they would milk one of the houses of cows. And they'd come in then to get ready for school and he would go out and take over.
And I can remember being put out in, there was a little porch.
In the school?
All these, the wet the clothes coach, from a wet day, I suppose. I can remember the smell of them. But I must have been there all day. I don't remember how long, but I do remember in the evening, Lily Marr was sent out with a bucket for my tears to fall into. So I must have been screaming. I don't know.
And do you remember the playing chants?
Yeah.
The choir,
I don't
you know.
Remember those, but I remember
and,
talking about it.
The Slieverue people, I know,
they'd meet in all the different parishes. It could be Kilmacow one year, it could be Glenmore another year, Mullinavat, you know, this area, we'll say, and they'd be, it's like competition. And you'd have so many hymns to sing. But Slieverue always wore, because we didn't have a uniform going to school, but for the plain chant, the girls had to wear green skirts and white blouses and white berries on their head.
From the school, we had a fete, as we used to call it, in the summer. And there was a big thing, like we used to have a big fancy dress parade in it, and oh, it was great.
And you'd be dressed up in the different costumes or whatever. And there was a lady, she's dead now, Lord Mercy, Margaret Power. She was great for making costumes. Great,
And people would dress up, dress and parade down from the national school down to there, and we'd have swinging boats and wheel of fortune. And
everybody had a job to do. And I was on the
spinner.
Wheel of spinner and selling tickets around. And
oh, there used to be a hurling match, and then there'd be a dance after it. There'd be a marquee in the dance after it. There used to be, in Manny's parish, there was, there were in Glenmore too, weren't
there? There were, yeah.
At that time.
Yeah. It was big that time. Yeah. It was really big.
But then we went to the fetes on bicycles. I remember I went to Ross one night. I'd say there were surely 30, 40 of us. And when we were coming home anyway, I suppose it was 3 a.m. or so, we all fell off of the bikes over around, you know where Pascal died, the Rood Lane? So they weren't a hope in hell, sure. All the bicycles was knotted up and one couldn't get up. So if they did get up, there's someone else knocking back again.
Then they'd be dancing, you'd be going up, and we were young, looking at her. I always remember Anne Crowe and Benny Kiley and the lovely dresses they used to have them on. They'd be going in, we'd be there just looking because we were too young, like, to be going, you know.
The one thing used to stand out, and you reminded me, Pauline, of it, is the bazaar.
Oh, the bazaar. The feeling on the wheels.
Then they had the Christmas bazaars in the hall. And they used to go on for 2 weekends.
Did they?
Did you, yeah. They'd have the spinner in the
spinner. Yeah, but there was another one over just inside the door where it was like the casinos in Vegas. Yeah.
And then they'd have the produce stall, and then they'd have rings and different things. You were raising money for the Vincent de Paul, it used to be back then, like, you know what I mean?
That was huge. I remember winning a picture of Pope John Paul.
I was asked one day, I was coming out of Mass on Sunday morning, and Michael Griffin called me across. You might have even been with him. No, I can't remember. They were looking for somebody to take part in a play called Scythe. It was, I suppose it was rough and ready, really, because it was the first one we did. And even I think we put up the, built a set and a stage the night before we went on. There was probably at that time maybe 40 or 50 people at it per night. You know, it seemed very sparse, but the hall was small. And from that year on then, it got better and better, and we kind of got came to grips with things and were able to prepare a little better each time.
Should we say when we were in the tech in about the 1955 or that, there was an adult class after starting there as well?
That was a wonderful, wonderful educational unit that Dr. Hughes, started, and he kind of built it by voluntary labour.
Yeah, he started off down in the hall in Slieverue. That's where he started it.
That's right,
and I think he started with much more just basic woodwork and a few more subjects.
Mm. The lads who kind of went in, the first students there, they built it. They gave a hand to build it.
I remember we used to go to some of the night classes there, and the teacher used to have to turn on the rings of the cooker to heat up the place for us.
Yeah, the step for me, I don't know, for me, going from primary to the tech was a whole change in culture altogether.
Like, because you were afraid to turn sideways in the primary, you know. But the tech was, I'd say, very laid back.
The thing about the teachers and the pupils, it's up to yourself if you wanted to learn.
Even if your mate couldn't get through to you, he'd say, oh, poor Ireland.
Nobody had the answer in class. Nobody knew what he was saying. He'd say, he'd scratch his head, and he'd say, I think I'll leave the country and go to Mullinavat.
I don't think there was any such thing as bullying or picking on. Or we didn't have to wear a uniform, so we wore what we wanted. And sometimes Miss Kern wasn't too impressed with my miniskirt, but, you know, I was well impressed with it.
Yeah. You know, that Taken Slieverua had a unique group of teachers there. They were all, they seemed to be cut from the same block.
She did tell us that if we didn't lower our hems, she was going to tack newspaper. She was the home economics teacher.
She didn't.
Yeah. She did. She said she would tack newspaper all along the end of our skirts, and we would have to walk around all day with the newspaper tacked to our skirts.
Christy Shaw, you wouldn't get anything like him. I mean, he was just amazing. He used to come into the class always with big, long ash, you know. I think he used to smoke carols.
Christy Fuhr, who was the, was the founder of the school, like, he would come in and tell you, there's a job going here.
And he'd come over behind you, you know, and he'd be pointing this and that out to you, and the ash would be getting longer and longer, and eventually the ash would fall down, you know. And all over the bloody place, and all he'd do was just wipe it away.
We gained back our confidence, and they did nurture us, and then they did, like Anne said, they kind of looked out for us career-wise then, because I worked in Clover, and as did Marie, and I purely got Clover because of the contacts. Tech.
He found jobs to suit people, to suit students, didn't he, really, you know.
Your parents came from a time when they had no work, and they were if you had a pensionable job,
any of those good jobs,
you kind of stayed there.
And you go home
there,
and you give your mammy her few bucks every week.
I stayed there, but I had to leave when I got married. I got married when I was 18, and I had to leave. I had to leave Clovermeads. Married women weren't allowed to work then, unless you went down to the Guthouse.
My father at the time, like where the Athenaeum Hotel is there now, that was a hostel for Clovermead's workers at the time, and he stayed there.
My mum now, she was from Kilmacow, but she actually worked in Clover in the factory, and she cycled so from Kilmacow, as did your mum.
And it was a pound per week, and his wages at the time were a pound and sixpence. So he hadn't much entertainment value, like, I mean, for what he had left.
In the war years then, there was the tyres for bicycles were all rationed.
The Clovermeads actually brought a lot of people from County Kilkenny, and from North Kilkenny in particular, down to work in Clovermeads and from the surrounding areas.
It was a hard time there, you know, because men were depending on the bicycles to go to Clovermeads, and they were cycled from Munkine and Mullinavat and everywhere.
I suppose he was there for 34 years when it closed down, and he would bring his bed to work with him. He would go in at 6 in the morning, he mightn't come home until 9 in the night.
And on a Saturday, the Clover worked half day on a Saturday, but he would bring meat for nearly
half
the country. He'd have big bags on the front of his bike and bags on the back of his bike.
And there was a number of vans on the road. There was about 7 or 8 vans on the road. And they went out every morning into different areas and did their calls to the shops.
Anytime he'd come in, he'd always say, God save
God all save all, here says Foxy
Ned. And my father would answer, and God save you kindly.
That's right.
When we started, people would put in their order, their meat order, and they'd have to put their name and their clock card number, and we'd write in all the orders. But half the time, they'd either forget a name or forget a number. So you'd recognise their writing. Yeah. You'd say, who's that now? They'd say,
they'd know their number.
And you'd know their number. So
that's Shawnee Kennedy.
He's 419.
I remember on Saturday morning, Mum would send us out up the ditch. There's a ditch all along from our house up to Walsh's, and the parcels of brown paper pass with the name and a number on them. And the men would have brought them home the previous night, but got drunk all along the way and dropped. We used to find 3 or 4 parcels every Saturday.
Do you remember the day we had the pig's foot? Yeah. Do you remember that? And I put it up my sleeve.
Yeah.
And do you know the way the pig's foot, you put the pen down between them, you put your hand up on the thing, right out there.
And we would have to go down to the house then with the parcels, because we'd have the number.
Then there was the Clover Centre, which was just up the road from Clover, which was a huge thing. Like, we all ended up then in Tops of the Town, which I'm sure you remember in Waterford was a huge thing. And Clover was big into Tops of the Town.
Paddy
Grant did it. And my brother worked in Ercom, Telecom, at the time. And they were in competition. And then the teachers...
And the Waterford Crystal.
And Waterford Black. It was huge.
Welcome to the Clover Show.
As we begin our opening night. Though we only have 1 hour. We try to make your heart feel light.
My sister Mary worked in Clovermeads before she went to England.
Clovermeads then closed in 1984.
That was a huge employment for Slieverue, whether you were 16 or 60. It employed young girls and older men. It was a big employer.
And tire soles. Tire soles. All the industries was here. And they were all like the Titanic. They all disappeared. And the mill below. There used to be a line of cars out of Ferris Slieverue here, bringing corn to the mill.
There was no opportunities here, sure. And at that time, if you wanted to do nursing, there were big fees to be paid to all the hospitals. And the bigger the hospital, the bigger the fee.
A lot of the people from the parish here went over to England. That was in the mid-50s and that.
So that's why so many Irish girls went over to England. Because in England, the hospitals were crying out for Irish nurses. And there was no fee. You walked in and you got paid from the time you came. When I went over, I got £5 a week. I thought I was in heaven.
In the early 80s, like, no one had a job, you know. The amount of people that left and went to England, all young chaps in the village. Like, there was, at one stage there, I'd say 12 chaps together went to England.
The most sad part of it all was that you see the boats and all the people leaving the country and all the relations, and they wave them goodbye to them. And all the tears, they shedding the tears. So I remember that well now.
He kept on walking. She kept on talking. Till her father's cottage came into view. She said, "Come in, sir, and meet my father, and for to please him, the foggy Jew."
The original church was Knockanafrin, which was up just behind the present one. And that's where the penal masses and all were said. And there were mass pats to them. And the mass pats came from the river, Waterford. Up, dead straight to the church. If you're in Waterford, in Ferrybank, you go in there and you come straight up, and you come back valleys and all, and come down the hill, and some would go over to the Commons in Ballinamona, because that was the school one there. The other mass pats would come out there down the end of the village here. But from the river to the church was dead straight.
Slieverue Parish was from Waterford Bridge to Shambo one time. Yeah. In the 1600s, they had the scarcity of priests, so they amalgamated parishes, and this parish was the parish wide, they called it, and it went from Ferrybank, or from the bridge, mm-hmm. to Shambo.
The parish in Slieverue, there was an older parish of Ida, which kind of was set up in the 1620s, and that kept going until the 1840s. So that would have been basically what's now Glenmore, Slieverue and Ferrybank were all kind of combined. And then they were divided in the 1840s.
Glenmore became a parish in its own right. So that left Slieverue and Glenmore.
We had the parish of Slieverue, which would have been basically Slieverue and Ferrybank kind of joined together. That was Slieverue. And the church, the parish church now in Ferrybank, that would have been built as a chapel of ease from Slieverue into Waterford. And then Ferrybank was established as its own parish in 1970, which was quite recent. And Slieverue then kind of became as what we would know it now as Slieverue Parish, only at that stage.
And that left Slieverue very reduced. And then, recently, there was an effort to take away a third of the parish again.
Then the church itself was built by subscription, so the normal parishioners put their hand in their pocket, and the church was constructed at that stage. And the land for the church was given by John Snow of Snow Hill in memory of his wife. And four masses were to be said every year in for the repose of her soul, and that had happened certainly right up into the 20th century.
That one is my parents' wedding. So that was 52 years ago this year. That's actually my granduncle, Father Pat. But the thing about this, I suppose, that this is the altar here. So this is the wooden actual altar table. And here we have, these are some of the altar rails, which is completely alien sort of to us now to see altar rails. That's just the same shot from the other side. So these are the the altar rails right around here, and then you can see how high the priest is.
The farmer's wives, rather, actually, they dreaded having a threshing on a Friday, because that means they'd have to have fish. Fish wasn't allowed. Yeah. No, meat wasn't allowed on Friday. That was a no-no.
You have fish for everybody.
You have to have fish for everyone. Yeah.
That time you'd have May devotions and October devotions. And you'd have the confraternity the first Sunday in the month.
And what they used to do was get, is what they call the Newland? What the
Newfoundland.
Newfoundland.
Lingfish.
Lingfish.
Yeah. Yeah, Newfoundland.
And that would be salted in
a
store.
As hard as a board, we hanging on the shop door down in Hanrans.
That would keep, oh yeah.
That would keep for
that would, you have to steep that for about 2 days because to get the salt out of it.
I remember going over for the cross put up on Kerry Mlinor Rock that time. Walking over the stations of the cross up and going over to have that blessed. That was 1950.
Oh, I was only a kid and we were at Mass. I used to go to Mass with Granny because Grandad would be gone before us and maybe be in next door before he'd go to Mass. And he would go down through the fields and he would be in the village. In a flash, and we'd be going over the road with our nice polished shoes.
And every Holy Thursday, we'd be surely above at the garage, sewing the spuds, and everyone else would be going up to the church on a Good Friday. And I used to be saying to me, Father, name of God, I said, all the people going up. Ah, he said, they're all right. He said, let them off. He said, you can go up tonight.
Men was up on the men's gallery, and then there was the women's gallery at this side and then the choir gallery down at the other end.
We technically call them the transepts, but to us the men's side and the women's side, which it always is.
You know, the old...
My father had the radio here.
Battery
radio.
And car radio. when the matches would be on now, the place would be... They wouldn't go home. There was two masses here every Sunday.
Yeah.
9 o'clock and 11. But they wouldn't go home from, the men wouldn't go home from 11 o'clock mass. They would stay around because you got inside the chairs, you know. And then when it got full, they'd be outside.
So and out at the lane.
And there was a window there. No, there was a window there, you know. Yeah. And you had to open the window and the heads were in the window.
Listen to
that. Easter Saturday night. You brought up whatever you wanted to get blessed.
What you'd bring is a sample of the seeds, a portion of the seeds from what you were growing.
You know, if you had cocks and hens and turkey cocks and turkey hens and ducks and that, you brought up an egg from each category up to the church.
And you left them along at the seat, you know, just before you kneel down.
They'd be laid there on the back seat for Mass on Easter Saturday morning, which would be at 7 o'clock or 7:30, I think. And there used to be three Masses. So when the Masses would be over, the priest would come down and bless all the fruits of the earth.
And you get the holy water as well, coming home and sprinkle it on the different fields and in the cow shed. And
that was done every Easter. But them days are gone now again.
Yeah. Same for St. Bridget's Crosses. St. Bridget's Cross, there were great adoration and great respect for St. Bridget. And that would be hanging up in the cow shed to hopefully help keep away sickness and that.
I have a favourite saint and I still have her. And that's Our Lady of Lourdes. I even have her on the keyring. And I've never known her to fail me, yes.
I don't know if you call it superstition or if you call it faith.
Faith, okay.
It was more faith. Okay. The people did believe in those things, you know, that it was right and that it was kind of going to happen. And
one thing, coming home, the ditches now, when we'd be coming home, the wild woodbine used to be out. And often you see the lilac, you know, there'd be a tree someplace. And they'd always say to you, well, if you're going to pick those going home, don't ever bring them into the house, they're unlucky.
The house up the way, the next house up the road. They put out a major, families believed in that.
Yeah, all they did.
Knox has now always put out a Maybush out. See, Tommy Knox had the Maybush out.
Go on.
And you put, I suppose, the start of the fine weather and all that was the thing of that, and different ribbons and strings and that on the Maybush, you know.
Oh yes, hawthorn, yes, the hawthorn. Like at home now, and in most places, like we had a big manure heap in front of the front yard, right in front of the front door. The May bush was put on top of that.
In May, like May Day, you don't go looking for anything, or you don't give anything. You look, they'd be saying you look, and you'd be going around with the holy water. Now, an awful lot of people still do it, that they scatter the holy water both inside and outside the house for, you know, the eve of May, the last day of April.
But, you know, and then they had a fairy fort on the land as well, you know, and she didn't get burned, but she lit a fire and fell asleep. Yeah, and it burnt all around the place, but it never touched her, me. And the mother was after warning her not to light a fire.
We have one on my land at present, yeah. At home.
Yeah.
We have a big fort there.
Yeah.
It's a big double ring fort.
Yeah.
And that we never touched it, of course.
No, people,
you know,
didn't
mean?
Ever.
And, like, for instance, we say, like, if their potato crop, like, had small spuds in it, they believed the fairies give the big spuds to the neighbours.
Can you see one fort from another fort?
That's what they always claim, yeah, that you can see one fort to the next one, wherever it is in the country.
Yeah.
Oh, they said the banshee is down Kilmurry Lane. So they told me anyway.
Which was day down there.
Oh, yeah, around the castle down there. Into Chair supposed to be in our castle.
Yeah, you'd hear about that. Whether it was real or not, I don't know. Maybe they were only seeing things.
As regards ghosts and banshees, my mother always claimed you'd never meet anyone worse than yourself.
We're picking down the gour one time, the work was pretty good. She said we shouldn't wait for the frost, I thought maybe we should. We're drinking more in those days, and tempers reached a pitch. And like a fool I let her go with the rambling itch. And the last I heard she was sleeping rough, back in the Derby beat. White horse in her hip pocket, and a wolfhound at her feet. And they said she even married once a man called Romany Brown, but even a gypsy caravan was too much settling down.
The only thing, we all huddled. We used to play huddles to school, and there were a field belonged to Lizzie Welsh. They had across from the old school, where the old school is, and that's where we used to huddle in there. They gave us the field, we used to hop in over the ditch and huddle there. But the teachers in Slieverue at the time, there were Mr. Carey in it in my time, and he had no interest whatsoever in huddling. Johnny Hokey was the man that actually really kind of organised hurling. At that stage, there were no organisation. Johnny got entered the team in as a club team, as a minor team, in 1945. And they didn't have, I think they had 11 jerseys or something that they could resurrect from the old team in the 30s. And they played Dunkit. After that match in the Mile Post, Dr. Hughes got on to organise a club, and they had a meeting in the Christmas of 45 or around spring of 46. I don't know when it could be. You had two clubs in Slieverue years ago, the Raheen Rovers and Slieverue. And they aired that night, I remember being at the meeting, and they aired that night to know what they were going to call the team. And Dr. Hughes was getting a bit fed up with it. Eventually they called it the Slieverue Rovers. That was the first club that was organised. But there's an awful lot of work after being done since. There's a lovely feel in it now. It is a credit to the club now, right?
When we were hurling in Ferrybank there, down at the back of what is now the community centre, there was a bit of a pitch there, a shortish pitch that we used to hurl on in the summer evenings. And so I suppose there could be 40 or 50 hurling.
Hurling, and that is very much ingrained in rural Ireland. Mm-hmm. It is, really.
There was a man down there, he's still alive, Harry Power. Harry used to sit up on the wall, the high wall, and he used to do a commentary. And the fellas would hear their name mentioned and the bristles would rise on the back of their neck because they think they were up in Crow Park playing a hurling match. They're going through hell's fire to get a score.
Well, they were always black and amber, but they weren't... They didn't have the original jersey. Now they've gone back to the original jersey. That's
the sash.
Yeah, with the sash down the side of them. We had only. But I remember we going to when they went to go play that first match. The old jerseys, they had the old jersey with the sash on them, but 11 of them was all they could get.
And I don't know, there were some of them around up to lately, I don't know where they went to. But that's the rest of them, there were no such thing as a jersey.
When Slieverue were playing in wherever, like, you know, you went to them, like in Munkine or wherever, you know, in summer's evenings and all that, you know, met all the people there, you know.
At that time, the Gaelic Athletic Association would object to you playing soccer or rugby in the local pitch, going back a good few years.
Yeah, and we used to have a lookout for anyone that's coming. We had a lookout just to watch. If anybody came along that was belonged to the club or committee or whatever, we used to put the ball in the air, we used to catch Gaelic football, you know.
I remember Tom Welch, who would have been part of the GEA structure in Slieverue. Tom would arrive up, maybe it could be even during the summer's day, and hunt us out of the field, because out of the hurling field, we'd be playing football and soccer, but not hurling or Gaelic football, just pure soccer.
At the time, you see, hurling, you might have one game a year, and if you're beaten in that match, you had no hurling then for the rest, and you had no games then for the rest of the year. So we started this soccer club at the time, and you're guaranteed maybe 20 games a year, like league games, cup games.
Everybody was involved in the hurling club. You know, that was the main club. But there was other clubs as well. I mean, I would have done athletics here. I was part of the badminton club here for a while. You know, they had different clubs here, and all the youngsters were kind of involved in something or another, you know.
And that's all we wanted, was games. It's not because we didn't like hurling or we didn't like Gaelic football. We liked them all, but you get more games of soccer if you were playing soccer, and you'd have more games, game time. And we just wanted to play.
Sport is the lifeblood of the youth anyhow.
I remember my grandfather saying to me, if your father finds out you're playing soccer, you're going to be in trouble. You know? I was saying, yeah, you know. My father never said a word anyway, you know.
Ferry in Ballinlough.
Yes.
That was a long way from here.
Down to Aggie and her husband, two of them are gone, Jim, he was a carpenter. He was from County Wexford.
I remember going down there and having a drink there in that pub.
It was a 6-day licence and there was no spirits.
But they'd always have their old bottle of whiskey under the counter. But they'd be careful who'd be around it.
Who'd get it,
like, you know what I mean?
It was a ferry service then to the other side, Wexford side.
You go across over there then at Camp Isle there, you know, it was lovely.
A licensed ferry crossing the river here, and apparently they had two boats, one for livestock and one for humans.
There'd be the fishermen down there now, and Paddy Diddle and them all long ago, and they'd bring you across in the little rowing boats, you know, that they go out fishing in and that.
Some of the men used to go down as far as Broom Hill, down there, not far from the Hook Head, in the summer, fishing, when there was salmon fishing, you know, they'd be drifting now. You drift down with the tide and then drift mostly come back up on the tide again. All the villages along Cheek Pine, Ballyhack and Passage, they all had a lot of fishing boats out, and, you know, they'd make a living in the summer. That's all finished.
Like, there was a bailiff in New Ross, Mikey Green. But at the time, he had a rowing boat. So to be a long time before he'd come down. And like my father was a kind of a lookout Like, especially at night, he might be going home late at night, and if he saw a bailiff coming, he'd light a fire on the hill, so everybody would see it, like, you know.
There was a Dominican that used to come around here.
Was that right? Yeah, I never
And my uncle got him to bless the nets. And the next day the bailiff came up and took him on.
The best of the season, like, the season started in February, but really the best of the season was June, July. And the end of the season was the 15th of August. And the 15th of August was a huge day in Tramore, and that was the end of the fishing season. And I do remember, I was never there myself at the time, but I do remember people talking about it. They had a big dance there in Tramore, and another big one in the Olympian Waterford on the 15th of August. And anybody, like all the fishermen went in, but anybody who wanted to pick a fight with somebody else was there as well. Whether it's about politics or about what, and there was always a good punch up at that particular dance, the 15th of August, and of course they would have been drinking all day anyway, so it kind of had the ingredients of a good night, like, you know.
Down on from Ferrybank right out to Drumdowney, the landowners there, mainly big landowners, they picked lovely sites and built lovely houses, high ground, in general overlooking the shore. A Snow Hill House would be one of those. Bellevue House would be another. Now, those were very significant places in the life of the parish. They gave good employment. A man called Richard Sheel bought Bellevue in 1780. He had been trading in wine and so on. The property, the land was for sale, and he bought it. And built a house on it, which he called Bellevue. Beautiful place.
The powers in Bellevue used to cross the river to the church in Faithlake every Sunday.
The other big house then was Snow Hill. Now, that had been the property of the Stranges, Strange or Strang, Strang's Mills. That family owned Strang's Mills. They were huge landowners. And again, the Stranges were sent packing by Cromwell. It was given to a family of Snow. They were British, they were from England, and they were tent makers in Cromwell's army. Most of those, they either gave money to the army coming to Ireland to sort out the Irish, or they weren't paid while they were here. So they had to be recompensed. And hence they got land and estates very often. Within 100 years, they had worn themselves out. The place was for sale again. And a man called Power, he bought that in 1808. And they survived there until 1945. The last of them was a lady, Violet Power. In the midst of all that, John O'Donovan was born in 1806. Donovan came from a farming background. His parents were tenant farmers, very different from the landed classes down here. And at that time, it was most unusual for somebody from Donovan's background to achieve any position, any public office. Hence the Ordnance Survey was starting in 1830. And John got a job as a field officer, going around the country, recording the names of the fields, the names of the castles, and the names of the houses, and etc., etc. Every item had to be recorded. And John was really a recording officer. He then translated the annals of the Four Masters. Now, the Four Masters were scholars who they were clergymen, who had collected ancient history up to 1616 from day one, as far as could be recorded, as far as they could go back. And but those now were in Old Irish, historical documents, and the people in that time, that period, couldn't read them, or couldn't understand them. O'Donovan could. He was a master of Old Irish, and he translated them into Modern Irish and into English, and that was acclaimed as a great achievement academically.
I came from Snow Hill, which is opposite Cheek Point at this side of the at our side of the river, and it was an estate, and it was owned by Violet O'Neill Power, and my family was involved with it from early 1900s because my grandfather was a land steward. There was quite a few people worked in Snow Hill at the time. It was a very big place, and there was a farm. They had a lot of tillage. There was always a three-day thrashing.
Inside in the house, you'd have about 20 men then at the thrashing. And you'd have to feed those.
Yeah, all the neighbours come around to the one every day, you know what
and
I mean?
You'd go to theirs,
and that's the way it worked.
That study, looking on there, I suppose Weber was taking the photo. He took time to look at him, and Jim was there as well, and Eddie was taking up a fork of hay to throw it up to him.
And there's a big pasture outside, a big pot of potatoes, and a big pot of cabbage or turnip.
That was the dinner.
That was the dinner.
And of course, they always then got they had a few firkins of beer.
Oh yes, always. And every so often they got a round of beer.
About every two hours, the threshing would stop, and the beer would be served out. In pints.
And of course, in our day, you had to combine minding the children with what else you had to do outside or inside.
Yeah. That's true.
And there were no such thing as babysitters. Well, there could be elderly people in the house or something like that.
Well, I suppose you had to toe the line, and you were given bits and pieces to do, and as you got a bit onto 10, 11 then, you were put to milk the cows and feed the calves and...
The men that followed, they could be from different parts of the country, maybe they used to come around, you know, bring their machine around.
Yeah.
And you would put them up for the night, and the next, where they went to the next farm, they would put them up,
yeah,
you know.
That's right.
They might go home the weekend.
Depending on the weather. The weather was good as well.
They always went home on a Sunday. Sunday, there was certainly no work done of a Sunday them days. If this farm today, they'd be at yours tomorrow, and they'd just go along like that.
But then parts of the country, the corn would be that bit earlier ripe.
Oh, they would, yeah.
They'd start there and work their way down.
And you'd have to wait your turn, Tim.
Yeah.
The 4th of May was the big fair day in Waterford. Yeah, and it was Ballybrick, and it'd be packed from end to end. But there were nothing up on Ballybrick in that time, only the bull ring. And the bull ring was there to tie bulls in it. That's why it was called the bull ring.
One buyer might buy 40 or 50 cattle in a fair, and they'd have to be driven from the fair over to Sally Park, to the train.
They'd
probably go up to meet or somewhere like that to be fattened.
Be loaded in the wagons.
And it was impossible. The cattle came from this side. They'd know when they're coming down the hill from Ballybricken, they were thinking they were going home.
Mm.
And to get them to turn to Sally Park was a job.
Mm.
It was absolutely a nightmare.
Mm.
You'd have to have five or six there turning them over to Sally Park because they wanted to come back this way.
Mm.
And then my grandfather then... he had a big, there were two or three fields, like, you know, and he used to till. I was actually going over this morning, and he used to till it after work. And eventually he was missing a stalk of spuds. Another time it could be a bit of cabbage. He used to keep the bees for honey. And one night he said to the wife, my grandmother, God rest her, he said, I'll have to report this to the sergeant, he said. You know, he said, things couldn't be getting missed that way, he said, constant. So he spoke to the sergeant anyway. The barrack was only up the road, and he spoke to him, and he said, I'll be gone, George, he said, I'll look after that for you. I'll keep an eye on that now, and the night I'll be up and throwing. So this went on anyway for a good while. And what did he do? He said, said the wife, my grandmother, he said, I must up tonight, he said, I'm about to get in the church. And I must see, he said, who's taken up all the things, he said, and I'm missing them after sewing them and everything else, he said, like that. So he hid above, and I came to 1 o'clock in the morning. And the next thing, here's this fella, and he helping himself. So he just turned on the torch. Who do you think it was? The sergeant. And he was stealing them.
When I were a young man, I carried my pack, and I lived the free life of the rover. From the Murray's great basin to the dusty outback, I waltzed my Matilda all over. Then in 1915, my country said, son, it's time to stop rambling, 'cause there's work to be done.
What really got me absorbed in history was EIGSE Slieverua. Now, that was formed in 78. And when I saw what it meant to people and meant to myself, I got very interested.
At this time, precisely this time, 40 years ago, the seeds of EIGSE were being sown, being planted. And in due course, the plant flowered very well and is still flowering.
Doesn't it actually show you how rich local life is? The
absolutely
fact that you can sustain,
yeah,
you know, an EIGSE, yeah, over 40 years. Dick was a scholar with the Celtic Studies School within the Dublin Institute of Advanced Studies. And in that, he kind of got this great love of a sense of place, you know, what it meant to be Irish, but more importantly, what it meant to be Irish in a particular location. And in a sense, that's what EIGSE became, you know, this idea that we are all connected and we're all part of our own native place.
Things weren't as hard as you think they were.
Like, when you look back and when you think back on the times that we had, like,
you know, it's just things. The village is kind of literally moving on and disappearing bit by bit.
I can get the smell. I can get the feel. The,
yeah, exactly,
I don't know,
yeah.
It's just, we're on television.
Just when you're growing up as well, and your parents, if your parents and your grandparents were talking about that, you wouldn't have the interest
at
the time. But you know, often I would have said, you know, it's a pity we didn't listen more.
See, there's no end to local history, and it's amazing how much local, how much history there is every place.
Like, things weren't that awful at all if you could go back and realise all the good things you had.
That was our life, which was a terrific. We had a terrific time.
He loves our far away.
Please.
Maybe your voice is just a word away. Maybe this light in my mind is the sight of your smile on the shores of the day. Maybe your hands are holding me together. Maybe your whisper keeps my tears at bay. Maybe you
Baffin Bay, where the fish blow. The fate of Franklin no man may know. The fate of Franklin no tongue can tell. Lord Franklin and his sailors do dwell. Now my burden, it gives me pain. My long lost Franklin lies across the main. 10,000 pounds would I freely give to know on earth if my Franklin